Hi and welcome to a new, not episode of Lectures About Magic. This is the first part of my FAQ series. So, frequently asked questions. The first of those is, should I join a lodge, an order, or whatever? There is no real answer to that question. It depends on who you are and what you want. But the most important thing is, before you join such a group, find out who they are and what they do. It's a waste of time when you find out after several years that you joined the wrong group. And when you look at different groups, you might find that in the inner circles they are doing something completely different. An example for that would be the AMORC, A-M-O-R-C. They pretend to be, or they claim to be Rosicrucians, but when you take a close look at that group, in the inner circle they are Martinists. So they are doing something that is, all right, I have to admit, related to Rosicrucianism. But there is still a difference between Martinism and Rosicrucianism. The same for most other Rosicrucian groups. You could say that a group that says publicly we are Rosicrucians consists of something entirely different on the inside. There is another aspect to the whole thing, to the whole question about joining a group, and that's the aspect of what's the use of it, or the role of the importance of lodges in the previous centuries and the situation today. 100 years ago and before that, in the 19th and 18th century, joining a lodge was something quite good for people who wanted to learn about occultism, about magic and all that stuff. Because in those days, learning about occultism and magic and all that was something quite dangerous. Could be if people learned about someone dabbling with magic, it could result in that people, that person, kind of getting expelled from social life. It could be something like social suicide. Nowadays, the situation has changed. Not everywhere, but in most parts. And in previous centuries, lodges had an important role in the whole thing. Because inside of the lodges, there were libraries. You could find forbidden books, banned books, in the lodges. You could find people that could teach you, or people that you could work with in rituals with many people, and so group rituals, group workings. You could people who shared the same interest as you. And when you went to a different city or a foreign nation, and you knew there was a lodge of the same system, you could just go in there, give them the passwords and the signs and all those funky things, and you would be accepted and protected by them in the same way that you were protected in your home lodge, or in the group that you were coming from. Well, nowadays we have the internet, and in the internet you can find lots of stuff. Books, information, you can learn, you can meet people, you can find all that stuff that you could find in lodges in previous centuries. And you don't, well, instead of paying money to a lodge on a monthly basis, nowadays you pay money to your provider. And not for getting in contact with those people, but just to get access to the internet. I think that's a big advantage. So, you could say the internet killed the lodge masters. What else? There's the claim, of course, that you can find with some lodges and some systems of initiation that the only way to get ahead in mysticism and magic is to get an initiation by that group. Now, of course, such a claim is a bit strong, to say the least. Everybody can fake some line of succession. Anybody can pretend to be the great I don't know what kind of master. But it's hard to get a proof of that. It's real hard for a person who wants to join such a group to find out if those claims are genuine or just lies. So, well, you gotta be careful before you join such a group. Especially since there are groups that have some doctrine of binding yourself for eternity or whatever for the rest of your life to the group. In the OTO, that point of binding to the group that can't be solved, or binding to some principle that can't be solved, comes with the first initiation. In the Fraternita Saturni, it comes with the first master's degree, that's the 12th degree. And I think in most groups there is such a point where they say, from now on you're forever bound to this or that principle, or you can't get out. And you should really think about if you want to do that or not. Personally, I didn't want to do that. That's why I left the lodge that I was a member in. What else? Oh yeah, one point, some people asked me or told me that they joined Freemasonic lodges to learn something about magic. I think that's not the right way, because Freemasonry is not about learning how to practice magic. Freemasonry is about working on the rough stone, or whatever that thing is called in English. It's about improving yourself and making yourself a better person. And from the videos from the Freemasonic videos I found on YouTube, I have to say they are quite successful with that. Although, on the other hand, the Masons I met here in Germany led me to the remark that about 50% of them are assholes. But that's German Masonry. It's a bit different than the kind of Masonry done in Anglo-Saxon, in the Anglo-Saxon parts of the world. So, joining a Masonic lodge is not the right way if you want to learn something about magic. Especially since something like that is only part of the high degrees, not of the blue degrees. And when you join a lodge, you should be sure you should make sure that you're really joining a lodge that allows you access to a high degree system where you can learn something about magic. And that's not every high degree system. Well, I think that's everything I wanted to say about that. If I forgot something, I have to do another video, but, well, that's my problem then. So I hope I did kind of help or answer, or at least give hints into the right directions for those people who have that question in mind. If not so, please leave comments and point out what I forgot. Yeah, that's it for this time. Have fun and enjoy life and everything else. See ya.